A light at the end of the tunnel. We end as we began, with a map. You've been so busy focusing on Antarctica and all the lies of the satanic cabal that you forgot to examine the location that brought you here in the first place. The North Pole at the center of Gleason's map and the flat plain we call Earth. Gerardus Mercator was a Flemish geographer and cartographer and is responsible for the Mercator projection for navigation, in which north is up and south is down. It is pretty much the same map we refer to today as the standard map of Earth. A year after his death in 1595, Mercator's family compiled his life's work into an atlas, which contained his earlier works. Here is one of his atlases produced in 1569. The map's polar extremities of north and south are represented by huge bodies of land. In panel 13, a more detailed look of the North Pole or the Arctic is provided. It shows a quasi-circular body of land at the North Pole, separated into four quadrant continents, with what appears to be an island in the middle. Mercator's 1595 world map presents this Arctic region in more detail. The body of land or rock in the center of these four quadrant continents here is called Rupes Nigra, which translates to black rock. The official historians of the world tell us that Mercator's vision and influence came from the text Inventio Fortunata, a conveniently lost book containing a description of the North Pole as a mountain surrounded by a giant whirlpool and four continents with four directional rivers. Historians date the book to being created in the late 14th century and tell us that no pages or extracts of the lost book have ever been discovered. There are a vast amount of maps from this era, from all different cultures, that depict the North Pole in a similar way. It is not until the 17th century that reference to the North Poles, mountain, four continents, and four directional rivers starts to disappear from cartography, like a Photoshop erasure job. This coincides and aligns with the rise of Galileo, the father of heliocentrism. They tell us there is no land at the North Pole, just a large ice sheet. Google Earth, however, refuses to even give us the ice sheets. They love to show us their thwarted version of Antarctica, but when venturing north, all that remains is Greenland. Look at Greenland here. Edges of real land before a huge mass of white engulfs the entire country. This does not look real. They claim that Google Earth works by superimposing satellite images, aerial photography, and GIS data onto a 3D globe. That's great. So where are the perpetual ice sheets at the Arctic Sea? A closer look at the North Pole here is very telling. Zooming into this little island, something interesting appears. A glitch in the matrix. A line that runs from this island to the center of the Arctic Sea. Deliberate mocking on their part, or just amateur NASA-style Photoshop skills. Either way, it indicates that the vast nothingness of blue ocean here is indeed a Photoshopped lie and exists primarily to hide whatever is really here. Perhaps Mercator and the early cartographers just got it wrong. Mercator was no joke in his day. His maps were not merely fantastical creations of the world as he dreamed up and saw fit. He was known for his meticulous accuracy. And, as stated earlier, he later developed the Mercator projection, which is still used today for navigation. The Inventio Fortunata is lost, and has never been found in its entirety or extract. But an old letter from Mercator to John Dee, the advisor to Queen Elizabeth I, provides insight. John Dee wrote to Mercator to inquire about the North Pole. In his reply, Mercator paraphrased the Inventio Fortunata and provided a description of the region. In the midst of the four countries is a whirlpool, into which there empty these four indrawing seas, which divide the north, and the water rushes round and descends into the earth just as if one were pouring it through a filter funnel. It is 4 degrees wide on every side of the pole. That is to say, 8 degrees altogether, except that right under the pole, there lies a bare rock in the midst of the sea. Its circumference is almost 33 French miles, and it is all of magnetic stone, and is as high as the clouds. It is black and glistening. In Johann Rusch's 1508 map, the North Pole is represented in a similar manner, and the map's legend states, it is written in the Book of the Fortunata, under the Arctic Pole, there is a high magnetic rock 33 German miles in circumference. A surging sea surrounds this rock as if the water were discharged downward from a vase through an opening to four mouths below. Around are islands, of which two are inhabited. Here the ship's compass loses its property, and no vessel with iron on board is able to get away. A magnetic rock or mountain at the center, at the North Pole, with the northern star Polaris, fixed right above, unchanging, while the rest of the stars and constellations in the firmament revolve around it. Could the source of all magnetism and electromagnetism on Earth emanate from this magnetic mountain? It is an undisputable fact that compasses point north. But the satanic cabal tell us that the Earth is a spinning globe with two magnetic poles, the north and the south. Yet no matter how far we go south, the compass's needle never shifts and begins pointing south. It always points north. Is the north's magnetic pole just stronger than the south's and able to overpower it no matter how south you go? Or is somebody lying? And what about this whirlpool? The vortex at the center. Do the oceans really collect through four rivers and descend into the earth itself like a funnel or a vase? Would that even be possible? Do you remember what happened to water in the bowl with the magnet? Water is diamagnetic. It would certainly resist a large magnetic mountain. Is the North Pole really Earth's very own rabbit hole? And again, if this were true, why lie? It's entirely possible to let people know about this mountain and whirlpool and make it compatible with their satanic, heliocentric model. The rabbit hole goes a lot deeper than you realize. It's hard to imagine a bigger secret than flat Earth itself. The firmament, the giant trees and quarried land. But there is one. It could very well perhaps be the most satanic lie of them all. Just perhaps. As always, the clues are hiding in plain sight. In the symbolism, in the mythology, the language, the metaphors, the movies, waiting patiently to be discovered. If we were to take them at their word and believe that Mercator and other renowned cartographers of the time were just influenced by a now missing book, the journey would end here. But by now, we know better than that. History is a corruption. The truth has been shattered, fragmented, mythologized, and scattered. All cultures throughout time have spoken of an ancient and sacred land. The ancient Greeks called this place Hyperborea, a land of perpetual sun. They said the people of Hyperborea were giants that lived for 1,000 years and enjoyed a life of happiness. Look at that word. Hyper is a prefix meaning beyond, and Boreas was the god of the north wind. Hyperborea, beyond the north wind. It is reminiscent of another word, the Aurora Borealis, the northern lights. The Hindu and Buddhist traditions speak of this legendary land as Shambhala. In Buddhist mythology, Mount Meru has its roots in hell and its summit in heaven, and is the bridge between Earth's realms. Scholars have pondered the location of Shambhala, writing that the literature frequently asserts that the world axis is associated with the center of Shambhala, and therefore it cannot possibly coincide with the Earth's spin axis unless Shambhala lies at the North Pole. Numerous sources support the tradition that Shambhala once lay near the North Pole. The Scythians, a branch of the Vedic peoples who roamed the Central Asian steppe, told of a wonderful place similar to Shambhala that lay far to the north. In most Asian cosmology, Mount Meru stands at the center. Look at the cosmological geometry here. Mount Meru at the center with four surrounding continent lands. In the fountain source of occultism, Paraka writes, this spot is the summit of what in the Hindu Puranas is called Shveta Dvipa, Mount Meru, or Sumeru. It is the North Pole of the Earth. It is the mystical North Pole. The Japanese spoke of the island of the congealed drop, which was placed at the North Pole. The Vedics called this land Paradisha. René Guénon in The King of the World writes, according to the Vedas text and the Persian Avesta, Paradisha was literally located in the sense of the word at the pole. The ancient Hebrew word for Paradisha is Pardes, which translates to garden. In Norse mythology, we have Vergelmir, the whirlpool at the roots of the cosmic tree Yggdrasil, where we are told all rivers flow from. The ash is greatest of all trees and best. Its limbs spread out over all the world and stand above heaven. Three roots of the tree uphold it and stand exceeding broad. One is among the Aesir, another among the Rime giants, in that place where aforetime was the yawning void. The third stands over Niflheim, and under that root is Vergelmir. You've seen this before. Look closer, a circular rim of mountains, perhaps at first mistaken for the Antarctic ice ring, but compared to Mercator's four continents, surrounding Rupes Nigra, a circular rim of mountains. In the Bible, this land is called the Garden of Eden. In the middle of the garden were the tree of life and the tree of knowledge of good and evil. A river watering the garden flowed from Eden. From there it was separated into four headwaters. The same four headwaters that Mercator depicts in his map. Beautiful for situation, the joy of the whole earth is Mount Zion, on the sides of the north, the city of the great king. It has many names: Mount Zion, Mount Meru, Sumeru, Rupes Nigra, the Axis Mundi, the Cosmic Axis, the World Pillar, the World Tree, the Tree of Life. The connection at the center of this plane, connecting the above and the below. The source of God, the source of magnetism. The Book of Enoch is also consistent. And from there, I went to the middle of the earth and saw a blessed, well-watered place, which had branches which remained alive and sprouted from a tree which had been cut down. And there I saw a holy mountain, and under the mountain, to the east of it, there was water, and it flowed towards the south. All cultures have their own versions of this central axis, Mount Meru, or what the Bible refers to as the Tree of Life. Heaven's altar right here on earth. William D. Warren, in Paradise Found, states, "Is anywhere in the temple of nature there was to be an altar, it could only be here." That it was here finds a fresh and unexpected confirmation in the singular agreement of many ancient religions and mythologies in associating their paradise tree with the axis of the world, or otherwise with equal unmistakableness locating it at the Arctic pole of the earth. The North Pole is truly the land of a thousand names. In accounts of his voyage in search of the Garden of Eden, Irish Saint Brendan, also known as the Navigator, journeyed to the north past Iceland and Greenland and recounts seeing great crystal pillars. A lot of Celtic mythology centers around the northern regions, with many believing that the real location of the Arthurian Avalon is actually at the center, the North Pole. Interestingly, the same John Dee that wrote to Mercator claimed that King Arthur conquered the far northern region, According to John Dee, another missing text, the Gesta Arthuri apparently contained an account of Arthur's expedition to the North Pole. Another text, the Leges Anglorum Londonis Collectae, testifies to this same expedition. Through Celtic mythology, King Arthur became associated with the North constellation, the Great Bear, otherwise known as Ursa Major. By Sir Walter Scott's day, King Arthur had become firmly associated with the Pole Star, or Polaris. In his 1805 work, Lay of the Last Minstrel, he states, Arthur's slow wane, his course doth roll in utter darkness round the pole. The northern bear lowers black and grim. Orion's studded belt is dim. The symbolism speaks louder than the corrupted history. King Arthur's Knights of the Round Table and the Western and Chinese zodiacs are strikingly similar. The Chinese zodiac table. It is our flat earth. The constellations of the dome or firmament circling the magnetic center, as do the yin yang of the sun and the moon. King Arthur and the 12 knights at the round table. 12 zodiac signs, 12 knights, with King Arthur's seat at the top, like Polaris. Look at the rose in the center. It is very similar to Mercator's representation of the North Pole. The four continents look like petals, and the magnetic mountain in the center looks like the plant stigma. Is the North Pole the true Holy Grail? The clock with its 12 hours, all time revolving around the center or the pole. There are 12 months in a year and 4 seasons, just like the 4 continents surrounding the pole. Our Earth is the oldest clock. 12 stars on the flag of Europe. Mercator's letter stated that Mount Meru, or Rupus Negra, was 33 miles in circumference. 33 again. The United Nations flag, split into 33 sections, with the final, largest section falling in the center. 33rd degree Freemasonry. During the course of initiation, the Mason is taught that the North is Masonically a place of darkness. The Freemasons worship East, West, and South, and forsake the North. This is because the North is associated with the energy of good. It is the source, the magnetic mountain, the Axis Mundi directly underneath Polaris, the fixed constant star. 33 is also the age Jesus was when crucified. Many scholars have drawn links between Jesus and King Arthur. Jesus had 12 disciples. Da Vinci's The Last Supper. 12 disciples revolve around the center, Christ. A closer look at the table shows an arched central base, suggesting it was actually a round table that has been halved and flattened for purposes of the painting, hidden in plain sight. Our first encounter with the North Pole is also one of the first deceptions we ever experience as humans. Saint Nicholas, or Santa, comes from the North Pole. Santa is an anagram of Satan and has ties to another mythological being, Krampus, a horned, half-goat, half-demon deity that punishes children who misbehave. I.e., it has its roots in the satanic practice of Moloch worship. Krampus is still worshipped today in many European countries. Can you see what they are doing? Contemporary Christmas practices have their roots in Victorian literature. Before that, the season still carried its true Christian practices and celebration of Christ. The satanic cabal has distorted and corrupted the true celebration of Christmas, tying satanic figures suggestive of child predation to the North Pole. As we grow up and find out Santa is a lie, we never give the North Pole another thought. It is the location of our first disillusion, our first painful truth. We are programmed to deliberately lose our sense of wonder for the North Pole. This usually coincides with the same time that we begin our heliocentric indoctrination at school. Christmas is a celebration of the birth of Christ, a celebration of the source of God. That's why we put up Christmas trees. The Christmas tree is Mount Meru, the Rupus Nigra, the tree of life. And the star on top is Polaris, the fixed star in the firmament. Humanity has collectively forgotten this. The Christmas tree is a celebration of the magnetic axis mundi at the center of our flat Earth. And it has subsequently been corrupted and replaced by debased materialism. We no longer remember what we are celebrating. The satanic cabal must corrupt the North Pole. They tell us it's just an ice sheet, but Google Earth cannot even give us a photoshopped version of the ice. They don't even want people interested in ice sheets. They can't even bear to acknowledge the North Pole. It is against their satanic religion. Hollywood movies always contain things hidden in plain sight. But there are a select few of these movies that are highly satanic and Masonic. The Truman Show is a metaphor for our programmed deception living under the dome. Rosemary's Baby, Monsters, Inc., and Eyes Wide Shut all depict the elite cult of Satanism and the practices of Moloch, child sacrifice, and adrenochrome harvesting. The Matrix is an obvious metaphor of humanity's slave status. The Matrix itself being the programmed deception cast upon humanity, who have no clue to the true nature of their reality. But there is another film, probably the most Masonic of them all, The Wizard of Oz, Dorothy's journey through the land of Oz. Notice the red shoes. Do you remember what Macaulay Culkin said about the red shoes? Dorothy and her unlikely band of friends must follow the yellow brick road to the Emerald City to ask the wizard if she can be sent home. The author, Lyman Frank Baum, developed maps for his land of Oz. Does this remind you of something? Four lands or continents surrounding the central Emerald City. Just like the North Pole in Mercator's map. Look at the representation of the Emerald City in the film. Look at the domed halo surrounding the city. Much like the halo we see with representations of Christ. But does it remind you of something? Look closer. Columns. Basalt columns. The magnetic tree of life at the center, also cut down in our history. The Emerald City. What else emits an emerald green glow? The Aurora Borealis. The Northern Lights. Look at the yellow brick road in the film. A swirl to the center. A whirlpool of sorts. Somewhere over the rainbow. The rainbow again. The Bifrost Bridge from Norse mythology. A path between heaven and earth. Between Midgard and Asgard. Bifrost means the swaying road to heaven. In Islam, it is called Al-Sirat. The narrow bridge people must pass in order to enter paradise. Look at the ancient Siam city in Thailand. This is supposed to be a recreation of Sumeru Mountain. Look at the bridge you have to cross on your journey. And what about the whirlpool at the center? Mercator described it as a filter funnel. Norse mythology labels it as Vergelmir, or the world's well. Could there really be a whirlpool opening in the center of Earth, caused by the magnetic tree of life in which the oceans flow down into? Paul the Deacon, an 8th century Benedictine monk, wrote that where the ocean extends without bounds is that very deep abyss of waters which we commonly call the ocean's navel. It is said twice a day to suck the waves into itself and to spew them out again, By the whirlpool of which we have spoken, it is asserted that ships are often drawn in with such rapidity. Gerald of Wales, royal clerk to King Henry II, wrote, "Not far from the islands towards the north, there is an astonishing whirlpool in the sea, towards which there is a set current of the waves from all quarters, until, pouring themselves into nature's secret recesses, they are swallowed up, as if it were, in the abyss." In the Historia Norwegiae, an anonymous 12th century Norwegian monk describes the exact same phenomenon. "The greatest of all whirlpools is to be found there, which engulfs the strongest ships. There is a very deep abyss in the earth itself, and alongside it are open-mouthed caverns containing winds. These winds draw to them the waters of the sea through hidden passages in the earth. They shut them up in the vaults of the abyss. The powerful source of magnetism offers some suggestion as to how this central vortex on Earth actually works. Not only is water diamagnetic and will resist gaining proximity to a magnetic mountain, creating an opening, but also a powerful magnetic source and a powerful central axis mundi would generate a strong electromagnetic field or electromagnetic stream. This takes the form of a toroidal electromagnetic field. Even in their heliocentric lie, they acknowledge that the Earth's magnetic field is toroidal, or shaped like a torus. The name Mercator, or Mercator, produces the seven-letter anagram Creator, or Creator, Tor, Toroidal, or Torus. The source of the toroidal magnetic field lies at the center, or the bull's eye, the bull, the torus. Do you see how they have corrupted the torus by making it synonymous with the horned animal? The toroidal electromagnetic field is a stream of all vibration, frequency, and energy on our flat plane. A constant dance of the above and the below, with our earthly plane in the center. The toroidal field draws the oceans in at the central axis mundi vortex. As the water is drawn into the center of the earth, it keeps going and is most likely drawn out again at the perimeters of Antarctica. Hence, that is why there is so much ice. It freezes because there is not much sunlight at the outer perimeters of flat earth. The ice has always melted at a constant rate, and this has been used recently to fuel the climate change hoax by the satanic cabal. This central vortex at the North Pole would also suggest the possible existence of the biblical Great Deep, and offer some clues to the existence of water above the firmament, all of which are outside of our perception's grasp and have been hidden from us. As absurd as this constant recycling of water sounds, the same process is happening right now inside of your body and never stops. Blood is pumped from the body into the right atrium and then is drawn up into the more central right valve to the lungs, which oxygenates the blood and pumps it into the left atrium at the heart's periphery, which is then drawn up into the central left valve back into the body. Speaking of the stars in the firmament, Enoch said that we shall err and take them to be gods. All planets in the fake solar system are named after false gods, such as Mars, Saturn, and Mercury. All of them apart from Earth. Earth is an interesting word, one of its kind. It is an anagram of heart. Look at the electromagnetic field of the human heart. It is a toroid. Look at the apple. It is the same shape as the toroid. What fruit did Satan tempt Eve with in the garden, the center of the earth? Hidden in plain sight, as above, so below, the microcosm and the macrocosm. What lies inside of Earth at this central vortex? Who knows? But it could explain the phenomena of the auroras at the poles. Perhaps the mysterious green light is atmospheric light coming from inner Earth, or the light emitted at the junction between realms. The word Aurora Borealis is very similar to the word Ouroboros, the serpent eating its own tail. A satanic symbol we see used over and over again. Many have speculated that the Ouroboros symbolizes the ice ring at Antarctica. Oro comes from the ancient Greek meaning for tail, and boros comes from the ancient Greek meaning for swallow. Boros is also very similar linguistically to Boreas, god of the north wind. The Ouroboros is also present in the Norse cosmology, circling the center. The Bible referred to it as Leviathan, a creature with no mate, its tail placed inside of its mouth. It signifies how the North Pole and the Antarctic ice ring meet in the continual, infinite recycling of the oceans caused by the flow of energy from a toroidal electromagnetic field. It also symbolizes the continual dance between good and evil, the good being the Arctic North Pole and the evil being Antarctica. The ant prefix of Antarctica is precisely the same prefix used to signify opposition and being against. The Arctic is Christ, and Antarctica is the Antichrist. So many of the satanic elite are obsessed with Antarctica. In the mythologies, It is only the pure of heart that can enter the North Pole Center. Hyperborea, the Emerald City, the Garden of Eden. And we see this motif play out over and over again in their satanic mocking of our ignorance. While they continually lead us further and further away from knowing the truth, keeping us rooted to giving our energy to their satanic matrix. The recent BFG movie shows the characters jumping into another realm at a center with a giant tree. Notice the aurora. Stephen King's The Dark Tower series places the magnetic Mount Meru, the Rupes Nigra, in the center. Notice the familiar map and the Arthur Rose. Look at a clip from the film.
It's a map. My father showed me a map like this once. Inside the circle is your world and my world. Many others. No one knows how many. The Dark Tower stands in the center of all things. And it stood there from the beginning of time. And it sends out powerful energy.
Interestingly, Stephen King also wrote another novel about life under the dome. Philip Pullman wrote a children's novel called The Northern Lights, in which the protagonist enters another realm through the aurora. Jules Verne's Journey to the Center of the Earth sees its protagonists enter Inner Earth in the north, just beyond Iceland. We have the Wandering Mountain in The Neverending Story. Notice the rainbow. Even the production company Paramount references this in its logo. Notice the dome stars above the Paramount, the Mount Meru, Mount Zion. We see reference to flat earth and the tree of life, Mount Meru, hidden in plain sight everywhere. George Bush International Airport, the flat earth map on the ground with a huge tree of life in the center, reaching up to the dome above. Darling Gardens in Sydney, Australia, the flat earth map again, with the Antarctic ice ring and the magnetic mountain in the center. Even the Central United Nations meeting room displays this imagery. Notice the starred dome above and the grand gold pillar in the center. What about flights? Wouldn't pilots have noticed if there were a huge vortex at the center of the Earth? Well, perhaps if they actually flew over the region. Flights are restricted, we are told, because it is too cold to fly over the Arctic and Antarctic regions. They tell us they have the technology to send people out into cold space, but not to cross the polar zones. In fact, a closer look at flight paths more generally exposes their heliocentric lie. On a globe Earth, South Africa to Australia should be a straight path over the Indian Ocean. They could even refuel at Madagascar if necessary. But no such flight exists. They all stop off at Dubai, Hong Kong, or Malaysia. A huge detour that makes no sense on a globe, but makes complete sense when looking at a flat Earth map. It's the direct flight path on flat Earth. We are running out of time. It is important to acknowledge the remaining and resistant beauty of our world, despite the vast amount of barbaric quarrying. It is undeniable that our flat Earth quarry retains aspects of beauty, sometimes so powerful it is described by humans as breathtaking. Although we are a species born out of the barbaric behavior of those who destroyed the Earth, carbon 12 is not the entirety of our biological design. Like the land, we retain elements of the good, which can be traced back to divine creation, or what is called God. Whether you view God as a being, vibration and magnetism itself, or something else does not matter. God is the source, the intelligence that designs and creates. Hexagonal efficiency is just one geometric design found in living organic matter. There is a sequence and ratio underpinning all geometric shapes, life, and matter itself. These are the Fibonacci sequence and the golden ratio. The Fibonacci sequence, the mathematical sequence of adding the last two numbers that came before, starting with 1. As the sequence continues, a constant ratio of 1 to 1.6 appears. This is called the golden ratio and continues indefinitely. To imagine what a 1 to 1.6 ratio looks like, compare it to a 1 to 1 ratio. Any rectangle with any two of the numbers of this Fibonacci sequence forms what is known as the golden rectangle, a perfect rectangle. This rectangle can be broken down into squares the size of the next Fibonacci numbers. Similarly, if you construct the rectangle with the 1 to 1.6 ratio and begin to make incremental golden ratio points within that, you end up with the same results as the Fibonacci sequence. If you divide each with an arc, then the pattern begins to take shape. We see Fibonacci's spiral, the spiral in and of itself. A spiral, spiraling out at the sequential ratio of 1 to 1.6, Fibonacci's spiral is literally found everywhere in the natural world, on both a microcosmic level and a macrocosmic level. It is the blueprint of all creation. It is not a coincidence that the entire education system pretty much ignores the golden ratio and golden spiral. We are not taught about this because the inevitable conclusion of understanding the omnipresence of this ratio is to acknowledge intelligent design and creation. It is the fingerprint of God. When viewed from above, the toroid takes on the shape of a spiral. Your brainwashing and programming has to have such a powerful grip over you if you think for 1 second our flat Earth itself would not take on the same ratio and patterning. A golden spiral concentrating into a central vortex at the North Pole. Do you see how they have taken the fingerprint of God, the spiral, and corrupted it through the most evil act that can be committed? The rape, torture, and murder of a child and drinking its blood. How to continue after discovering such evil exists and the deceptions cast upon humanity? What to do when things fall apart? When down becomes up and up is now down? When those you trusted the most deceived you and let you down. When the storm comes. Center yourself. Return to the center. And not in the way they tell you. There is a reason the satanic cabal pushes things like meditation and want you to participate in blind positivity. There is a reason that most organizations now subscribe to this narrative and ask you to attend to your well-being. They want you to accept that reality is stressful and full of corruption, to normalize it, and tell you the antidote is forced relaxation, to switch off and ignore, and forced positivity, which in reality is just to ignore the matter at hand and replace it with delusional positive thoughts. In other words, to turn a blind eye. The eye is a microcosm of flat Earth itself, with the pupil at the center, giving you sight. Center yourself, but not through their methods. There is only one way to achieve centrality and stillness. The eye of the storm. Immutable and still, while all around it energetic rage. The tree trunk, steadfast as the wind rattles its branches. The truth is objective. It cannot move, cannot bend, cannot fall apart. It is positively charged. It stands up to any counter-argument. And because of this, the truth is pure and is fixed. The fixed center of being. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. Stand firm then, with the belt of truth buckled around your waist. And knowing the world we live in, the journey to the center is going to be the journey of a lifetime. It's here. The end of the rabbit hole. The end of our small journey. There is so much we did not get to cover, but I hope you will not forget over time and keep on searching. Did I accomplish what I set out to achieve? Am I wiser? Do I know more? Perhaps a little. But the more truth I discovered, the less I truly know. The truth humbles and puts me in my place. But it is not a place of dislocation that believing in the Einsof heliocentric model of nothingness produces in an individual. You probably want to ask if I now believe in God. If you need to ask that question, then you haven't been paying attention. I didn't tell you before because I knew I wouldn't need to. But this isn't really an ending for me or for yourself. For I know that something in you, viewer, has forever changed. Whether it's your entire perspective of the earth, or just a small fraction of something that may nag at you during the late nights when sleep doesn't come. This isn't goodbye, and this is not an exit. It's actually the beginning. You're not really leaving the rabbit hole. You cannot leave the rabbit hole now. You've seen too much. The road doesn't end here. It's just a brief pause at the crossroads of another entrance to another rabbit hole. The journey of a lifetime. And who knows where it will lead you, viewer. But let's hope it's closer to the center.